So here with Mike Mendoza for this episode of Vote. It's been a while, Mike, hasn't it? And we've lots happened since we last spoke. So we're going to have a bit of a catch-up, local catch-up, national catch-up, plus we're going to talk about travel. Start off with locally. The selection's coming up, isn't it? And Adur and Worthing next year.
In May next year, yeah.
Tell us about that, because that's going to be quite an interesting kind of campaign. Because I imagine they're starting campaigning now, are they not, for next year?
I think they campaign non-stop at the moment, because don't forget we had an election in May of this year, which was meant to be for the year before. So they're playing catch-up now. So now we've got elections yet again in May, where a number of people who were elected last May will now be up again in next May. So, of course, they're campaigning all the time. Labour took seats, Greens took seats in Worthing for the first time. So at the moment, I think the Conservatives are very worried on Worthing Council, worried that it's actually going to go Labour.
Word has it that it will go Labour. And I think, actually, some people I know are almost preparing for a Labour government, because what will we see differently in Worthing, do you think? Given what they've done in Brighton, is the Labour Party in Worthing the same as what we see in Brighton, or are they distinct?
I'm not really sure, because we've never really seen much of them. They're real activists. You know, I think that's the reason why they haven't been voted in so far. People have been worried about them, been scared of them, but suddenly they really have taken off. Very much. Almost communist way of looking after people. Very supportive, of course, of the food banks, which is important to so many people. And they seem to get their shot in first behind the Conservatives. So really, their PR side is excellent. Conservatives seem to be standing back, watching what's going, and then joining in. Yeah. They all get involved in this, sort of clearing the rubbish up off the streets. That seems to be the in thing at the moment. And it's just going to be a question of seeing what's going to happen. A very anti-building programme.
Yeah.
So we may see a bit of a halt on the developments certainly in Worthing, and there's a lot of developments coming up at the moment there as well. A lot of protests about developments coming up in Adur as well.
Yeah, there is, along the seafront. I mean, I had a little stint at Adur and Worthing, the planning department there. Shoreham's really going to change, isn't it? I know that's not part of Worthing, but it's still part of that Adur political scene. We're going to get a lot of housing developments, aren't we, just off the Shoreham High Street as you approach it?
Well, actually, all the way along the seafront, the 259, all the former areas that were industrial are now going to have been all deemed to be residential. We're going to see a few blocks of flats, and there's planning coming up at the moment for a lot of flats and houses along that stretch from the Howard Kent site, which is where the lighthouse is, all the way up to the Frost site. Frost themselves, their site, they're looking at, I think, about 300 or 400 homes to go on there. So, you know, it's a massive site.
Yeah.
And people, the problem is this, infrastructure.
Yeah,
it looks like, at times, local authorities don't seem to take into consideration about the infrastructure. The roading system, is it sort of capable of taking so much traffic? Possibly not. Schools. Are there enough schools in the area? So there's going to be a 106. By the way, Adur and Worthing are the only councils that have kept with the S106 structure instead of going on to the new CIC structure.
Yeah, you talk about seal contributions, right?
So they've now opted to stick with the S106. Yeah. So you've got to look at more schools being built. Doctor surgeries, woefully under... manage that. So, you know, we need more doctor surgeries in both Adur and Worthing. Funny enough, when I was on planning on Adur many years ago now, one of the things I insisted when they were doing new developments on Shoreham Beach was a doctor surgery, and that was put into the planning approval. Never happened. You know, we were talking 15 years on, never happened, because the NHS said at the time, we're very well catered with the number of doctors in the area.
Yeah.
And at the moment, nearly all the doctor surgeries in Adur have now combined with each other and call themselves, I think, the Adur Medical Centre. Yeah. So we've now got about 6 or 7 different areas around Adur, all run by the same practice.
Yeah. So that housing is going to be an issue then. I mean, going back to Worthing, and what about? I mean, Worthing seems to be very, compared to Brighton, very clean. And I was there yesterday, actually, and it is all really clean around there. It seems to be quite well managed, to be honest.
A lot of my friends who have moved out of Brighton have moved to Adur and Worthing, Worthing in particular, and they've got this massive, great programme of improvements to go right along the Worthing seafront. And it looks great. What they've got planned is great. If Labour get in, they change all that, time will tell. They should actually, of course, embrace it and enhance it and enjoy what's been proposed.
Yeah, one issue in Worthing is the empty shops, isn't it? They do seem to have more empty shops than, say, in Brighton. I know Brighton's got quite a few, but it seems that it's less than in Worthing. Is that right?
Well, Montague Street, which is the main shopping area now, which is pedestrianised, I think most of those shops have taken. There's not that many empty shops there.
Right.
It's a very, very popular road. Plus, they put a lot of entertainment on there as well.
Yeah, yeah.
What they've done wrong is the beginning of Montague Street, where you had all the disabled parking. Most of that's been taken away now. Yeah. And they're now talking about completely pedestrianising that part of Montague Street as well, which is not a particularly good idea.
Yeah. What about cycle lanes in your area? I know it's been a big issue in Brighton. Are we going to see more cycle lanes in... I know that's a West Sussex County Council issue.
Yeah, well, there are no cycle lanes at the moment. They've all been taken out and away. There is a proposal for the Upper Shoreham Road, which is where I live, unfortunately, that may very well get a... They've had a consultation. That may get a cycle lane, one cycle lane along there.
Yeah. What else is going to be a political issue then ahead of the May elections next year? What do you think is going to come up on the agenda?
I think it's going to be the developments, the number of developments that are taking place without the infrastructure being in place. That's going to be, I think, the big concern for there.
Greens, do they stand a chance of making any more inroads in Adur? I mean, is this because a lot of people in Brighton have moved over to Adur and are carrying on their voting habits? Is that why we saw the Green representative on West Sussex County Council?
That's possible. Very much so. I think people have been scared of the Greens. If you remember, the Green Party were very strong in Brighton and Hove, and then suddenly they lost virtually every seat. Labour took over, and then it came back again with Greens got in again.
Yeah.
And the voting went similarly in both Adur and Worthing. Yeah. So there was no Greens voted at all. And then suddenly, this year, the first time ever... Don't forget, both Adur and Worthing were very, very strong Lib Dem areas at one time.
Yeah.
The Lib Dems were untouchable for years and years.
Yeah, yeah. Why do you think there's been a decline with the Lib Dem vote then? Obviously, they're almost extinct in Brighton, aren't they, pretty much?
But, well, they're virtually extinct in Adur and Worthing as well now, unfortunately. I mean, when I first got involved in politics in Adur and Worthing, I took out a Lib Dem seat in a by-election. And it sort of rolled on from there. There was no Lib Dems at all after that.
Yeah.
I just came back, 13, 14 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah. Nationally, then, let's look at the national picture. How do you think Boris has done then so far? He's got all of these crises kind of on his desk, hasn't he? It's almost non-stop. I mean, it must be
I really wouldn't like to be him.
Yeah, it's just...
You know, from virtually day one, had the floods.
Yeah.
He's had COVID. And he's had to fight all these things. Now we've got the gas emergency that's suddenly come up.
Yeah.
How in the hell is he going to sort this out?
And
of course, he's fallen out with his cabinet, I think. I think we've had this massive reshuffle recently.
Yeah.
People not happy with a lot of the reshuffle.
Yeah.
Probably a good thing. He's put a lot of women involved in there, which is very strange for him.
Yeah. Yeah. His poll ratings are going to go down for a bit. I mean, he's probably not going to get election to probably May 2023. So he's got a bit of time to sort it out, but not too much time, has he?
When it's due anyway, 2023?
It could be beyond that. I think they're repealing the Fixed Term Parliament Act anyway, so soon he'll be able to call it what he wants.
Last week, rumour, after the reshuffle, there will be a general election in 2022, next year.
Right.
And I think he'd be crazy to do that.
Yeah.
It'd be like Theresa May suddenly going for no reason, go for an election.
Yeah.
I think that's what you may do.
Yeah.
I think he's probably got too much self-confidence thinking people are going to vote for him.
Yeah.
Really.
Do you think his popularity has gone down a bit, hasn't it? The tax, the NHS and social care tax is going to hurt as well, isn't it? When that starts hitting people's pay packets, we're going to see a bit of a backlash probably against Boris, would you say?
Yeah. And of course, we heard the weekend that he contacted Amazon saying they're going to have to pay proper taxes.
Yeah.
So that's going to be an interesting one.
Yeah.
Suddenly see Amazon vanishing off the streets of England.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, let's move on to other issues then. The travel industry. Start talking about that. I mean, the cruise industry. Where are we with the cruisers? I mean, I've seen them advertise on TV. So
they're all advertising.
A bit of a budget for advertising. Are they getting bums on seats?
They started this over the last 7 or 8 months of cruising just around the UK. Unfortunately, and I don't think this has been publicised, one ship, which I won't name which one it is, did a cruise. The most popular one is going up to Liverpool and back, or they go up to Scotland and back. Friends of mine did one to the West Country and back. You do get out and go off and have a walk around wherever you go, apart from the West Country one. It's an interesting little cruise, and at least it gives you the experience of being on a cruise ship.
Yeah.
The cruise that went off to Liverpool about 3 or 4 weeks ago, suddenly 3 members of crew got COVID.
Yeah.
It hasn't been publicised, has it?
No, it hasn't.
I don't know why, but they had everyone to come back. They had to self-isolate when they got back. But the crew, of course, have all now been taken ashore and sorted out. But, you know, it's very dodgy. I mean, when we heard that with the P&O ship that time, when it first all started, and they were for months stuck at sea, weren't allowed to come back into the country.
Yeah.
I'm surprised that this ship wasn't actually taken away.
How about yourself, then? Are you going to be going on cruise ships?
We've got three booked, and we've cancelled all of them.
Right.
Until next year.
Right.
I wouldn't go in a plane at the moment, and I certainly wouldn't go in a ship at the moment.
Yeah.
Plus, cruising is so. We can talk about this in the next part if you want. But cruising is just so, so different.
Yeah.
And I'll explain to you why after.
We'll talk a bit about I think it is going to change. I've been lucky enough to go on quite a few cruises, and I can see it completely. My mindset would be completely changed on a cruise ship. Post-COVID, I would think differently. So we'll talk about that in the second half. Join us for the second half. I'll be chatting to Mike Mendoza a lot more about travel post-COVID. Join us then. Here with Mike Mendoza, latest TV presenter. We're going to be talking a bit more about the travel industry then. Cruising is going to be changed, isn't it, as we were saying. How do you think that is going to change? We'll talk a bit more about other travel, but after that.
I got friends who are actually going this weekend on a cruise. My brother, for some reason or other, and his family are going on a cruise at the end of this month. I think they're crazy. You had an experience, I think, recently of going to a well-known food chain or pub chain where you go for the buffet and they serve you.
Yeah.
And that is exactly what's happening on cruise ships.
Oh, right.
So there's no more self-service on the ships. You're going to be served. Oceania always served you anyway, even on the as you went through the buffet. So it's a bit like this. Yeah. It's not a big deal. If you want more, you can get more. The other thing is you've got walking around the ship, you've got to wear a mask. It's very uncomfortable for a lot of people. And I just can't send a lot of ports you go to. There's all the checking and what have you. So it's going to be a lot of holdups when you arrive at a port. This is the main reason why I'm not really interested in doing any cruising at the moment. It's just so different and so foreign.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, I can't imagine. I mean, the whole thing is like when you're on a cruise ship, it's kind of, it's like your little island, isn't it? And you don't want to explore it. I mean, you don't want to be wearing a mask. It's just not what you do when you're on holiday, is it? Especially if it's hot and sweaty, it's not the kind of environment, it's not a working environment, a holiday environment.
Yeah, we were doing 3 or 4 cruises a year at one time, and my very first experience of seeing a cruise ship, and you walk up to the wharf and you suddenly see this massive ship in front of you, and it's like a block of flats. You think, how in the hell is that going to go out in the water and you get back there and back safely?
Yeah.
But it's a magnificent sight. If you've never tried cruising before, certainly go for it.
Yeah.
It's absolutely an amazing experience. You just do it once and say, I didn't like it. But I don't know anybody who's been on a cruise and said they don't like it.
Yeah.
Not yet.
Yeah, exactly. What's exciting about it is you can go into different ports and you don't have to take all your luggage with you. You can just to wear shorts and T-shirt.
You wake up next morning and you're in a different country.
Yeah, I mean, it is. So I think it will return. Do you think travel is going to get back to where it was pre-COVID pandemic levels? Because we've been told that traffic levels are actually back to pre-COVID pandemic levels as of last week. What about travel industry and flights, etc.?
Well, flights has been the problem. I think Emirates are still flying from Heathrow. They're still not going into Gatwick. I'm not sure. I think it's only EasyJet flying into Gatwick at the moment, which seems a bit strange. I don't see why other airlines can't start using Gatwick again. I think Emirates discussed recently they may go back to Gatwick fairly soon.
Yeah.
So there's no reason, once everything gets back to normal, why we can't see that happening. But, of course, the government now lifted a lot of restrictions of travel, which, of course, is a godsend to many of those in the travel industry. And so we're going to just see a lot of change. But still, I just don't fancy going into a long metal tube. Although you've got to wear a mask, that's also going to be so uncomfortable sitting on a plane with a mask on all the time, isn't it, really?
Yeah, unless you fall asleep. I mean, I was just thinking how I would do it. The way I would do it, if it's only an hour and a half, I'd just probably just fall asleep and it wouldn't make any difference.
I do that anyway.
Yeah, exactly. I'd do that anyway. So, yeah. I mean, are we going to see a big growth in travel? I think, are people going to try and get away for the winter break then? If we're going to have fuel...
Maybe, fuel, but the cost is getting very high now. You think... They've got the money back somehow.
Yeah.
And they're getting back into business. So, people are going to start having to go on holidays. They're going to pay a little bit more. Probably a lot more in some places. All these adverts saying, it's now free to... Or, big reductions on this holiday and that holiday. Maybe last-minute ones, as before, you'll get some good deals. Talking about the cruise ships at the moment, nearly all the cruise ships are now doing the same thing. Gratuities are now included. In the past, you've had to pay gratuities at the end of a voyage.
At the end, you've had the end.
And to me, that's such a rip-off. you to be told this is what you've got to give the staff as a tip.
I think it was like 200 $1,000 or something.
Well, sometimes more. It depends on what grade you're on. Using internet is now going to be free as well. So the gratuities and the internet are going to be free.
Yeah.
And the other big thing, of course, is... I'm just going to say what the third one is now. You've got internet, gratuities, and...
Mini bar.
Drinks, thank you. Drinks package. So now they're going to include the drinks package as well. So the three big costs, which are the extras on a cruise normally, are now going to be included in your price. So obviously that's going to be reflected in the price. It's going to go up slightly.
Yeah, exactly,
But getting there, it depends where you go from. If I'm going to recommend anyone, they say, well, what would you recommend about cruising? I say, always go from Southampton.
Yeah.
It's so much easier. You park literally next to the ship. You're on and off. You're on and off so quickly. I mean, I've parked next to the ship and I could be actually in my cabin in 15, 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, you try and do that most holidays you go to. You know, sitting around airports for hours on end, getting on the airplane, flying to an airport, all the delays, all the problems you're having on there. Then you've got to get a taxi or a shuttle bus to where the ship is. Oh, it's horrible.
With the food element, do you think that's a good thing that they're serving it for you? Because there is a lot of waste on cruise ships, and some of it is a bit, you know, you can eat what you want, but if you waste that, I do notice there's a lot of plates.
Pile their plates up, don't they?
It seems obscene, doesn't it, the amount of food waste. So, I mean, if someone's serving it for you, is that a better thing, do you think? It's probably reduced the food waste, or does it
it's
really
more health-wise. I think it's really so you don't get any fingers. I mean, the amount of people go to a buffet and they're putting their fingers in it. The idea, of course, is to stop all that. So, no, I can't see any difference in waste. I mean, they cook and they prepare so much food, tons of food. They know there's going to be a big wastage.
Yeah.
And the other great thing is, if you rather than go on a formal night, is go into that buffet part of you're smiling now. Yeah. And you go into the buffet part, the buffet restaurant part, where there's hardly anybody in there because everyone's having a proper big meal. And they have the most enormous display of steaks and chops and what have you. And you get as much meat as you want. You know, if you're a steak eater and a chop eater like I am, it's just fantastic.
It really is.
But I mean, from Southampton, you go to some amazing countries to visit. So so just do it that way.
Yeah. Before we break finish up, and how do you see the COVID kind of playing out, flu playing out as well over the winter period? Because where do you see us? How are we going to be approaching the winter period? Do you think we're going to get this big spike in COVID rates
The
UK and globally?
We're already seeing numbers going up, aren't we? Unfortunately, I mean, I had my flu jab the weekend, so I think most people are going to get flu jabs over the next few weeks.
If you
walk into any chemist, walk into any chemist, and they will give you a flu jab.
Yeah.
So that's that sort of. We're talking about the third COVID jab, aren't we now?
Yeah.
I was told I'd probably get a third one in a couple of weeks' time. So as long as you're sensible about this, get the jab. If it's offered, get it.
Yeah.
You know, the amount of people who are protesting say, oh, we shouldn't be having the jabs. You've got to have it.
Yeah.
Really, there'll be so many more deaths. Look at the numbers. It's gone up slightly now, but nothing like it was last year.
No, it's tough. It's about hospitalisations as well, isn't it? And what about the economy then? I mean, it seems to be picking up, but we've had these snags with the truck drivers, now the fuel protests, we've had the climate change protests. It's problems are stacking up for businesses. I mean, how are you finding businesses in the Shoreham area? I know you're in touch with people on Shoreham High Street, Tosca and the other places. How are local businesses finding it?
The only place I've seen a problem has actually been Tesco's, the main big Tesco's at Homebush. For about two or three weeks, there was no milk there. But the strange thing is, you can go down to Lidl's or Aldi and they're full of milk. So I don't know what the hell's going on there. Maybe it's an argument between Tesco's and the suppliers. But a lot of fruit and veg areas of Tesco's and Homebush is empty. But again, go to Aldi and Lidl and it's all in there still.
Yeah.
So it could be a supply problem with their suppliers rather than truck drivers. They put the excuse down to truck drivers.
Yeah. And you don't think we'll get into another lockdown then? Do you think that's probably...
Well, Boris said there won't be one, didn't he? No, he's going to fight that to make sure there isn't.
Yeah.
I think there'll be uproar. I think a lot of people will refuse to do it anyway.
Yeah. You think so?
Yeah.
I mean, we thought that last time, didn't we, with the second, third lockdown, and it didn't happen. So... it's going to be interesting. I mean, I probably agree with you. I think that people probably wouldn't... Would we go back to that again? Do you think... I mean, it's
I can't see it. To me, it doesn't really matter. But when you've got to work properly for a living, things are slightly different.
Yeah.
You know, I'm meant to be retired or semi-retired.
Yeah.
So I can handle it. But for people who are relying on this income coming in, it's very, very difficult for them. You know, I really feel for people.
Yeah.
But the government have been fantastic over the last 18 months. You know, they've bent over backwards to help business and to help people.
Yeah, exactly.
And people have got to pay for it.
Exactly, yeah. What about the education? I mean, the education is an area where it's got difficult. And universities, I mean, paying for a degree when I've just done a degree, it's been mostly online. In fact, the whole thing was online. that was fine for it worked for me. But this idea that university students should university still imposing restrictions on students going into the university, even though they've got massive campuses half the time as well. What do you think of that? But still paying the same amount of tuition fees.
It's strange.
The highest tuition fees in the world.
Yeah, yeah. So, but the thing is, I think we've lost a lot of the overseas students, haven't we?
Yeah.
Because they haven't been able to come over and do what they want to do, to study the way they want to study. Someone's got to pay for it. You know, again, should the government get involved and should there be the subsidies there?
Yeah.
Maybe there should be.
Yeah.
You know, to expect students to pay this fortune is I feel so sorry for them.
What about like face masks then? Internet. Do you think a lot of people are just going to wear a face mask anywhere on public transport if they need to do it or not? I mean, I've spoken to a lot of friends and they'll say, well, it makes sense that everyone should wear a face mask on public transport. Like, I mean, I've been to Japan, they do it in Japan. Do you see that actually?
Yeah, Japan do it for a different reason, don't they? It's to stop the fumes.
Yeah.
That's their main thing. They say so much fumes in the street.
What do you think about being part of everyday life, though? Like,
it was for 18 months. You know, we went everywhere and we wore masks. I, over the last few weeks, have almost forgotten about face masks. I go out without one. I walk in the supermarket. I haven't seen anybody at all wearing a face mask in the big supermarket for the last few weeks.
Yeah. So you don't think it will be here for us to stay then? I mean, it is quite a big debating issue. I mean, you're kind of either pro or anti face mask in a lot of cases, aren't you? It's quite.
If we've got to wear them, I'm very happy to wear it.
Yeah.
Obviously, it's worked well.
Yeah, yeah. We'll leave it there, Mike.
Thank you.
And I know we're going to be catching up again soon. That's Mike Mendoza, and that was The Vote. Join us again soon.